So, a very good morning to all the students. There was a request from your batch regarding teaching of pyrimidine biosynthesis as well. That's the reason we'll complete in short and we'll move on to the genetics. So, the case 2, a 15-month-old boy, he's going to present with developmental delay. On peripheral smear examination, there was a picture of microcytic anemia. You can see larger RBCs. These are the larger RBCs. That means the patient has macrocytic anemia. Typically, it presents with megaloblastic anemia. When you look at the most common cause for macrocytic anemia would be a deficiency of vitamin B12 or folic acid. When the serum levels of them are measured, they are said to be normal. Then what is the diagnosis? So can anyone make a guesswork of what is the diagnosis in this baby or in this boy? So it is a case of orotic aciduria. Yeah, how this orotic aciduria is related to the megaloblastic anemia and why there is a developmental delay, we'll be discussing in the clinical significance of this chapter. Okay, so right now, just remember that the patient is suffering from the megaloblastic anemia secondary to orotic aciduria. What is the mechanism? We're going to understand in the next slides. So coming to the today's class about pyrimidine biosynthesis and degradation, we're going to study. And coming to the introduction part, unlike in a purine atom, we had 9 different atoms from different contributors of nitrogen and carbon. But here the pyrimidine looks very simple, and it has got a, it is a XR ring having 6 membrane ring. And most of the animals and mammals could, lower vertebrates can synthesize pyrimidines in our body. That's why we do not require in the diet, as it is like that of purine. We don't require in the diet, so we are prototropic because we can synthesize them. It is a heterocyclic ring. It has got 6 different atoms. When you look at the structure of the pyrimidine, it has got nitrogen 2 atoms and 4 carbon atoms. The first nitrogen and the carbon 4, carbon 5, carbon 6, they are derived from aspartate, and the carbon 2, CO2 contains 2 in it. So remember that the second carbon atom is derived from the respiratory carbon dioxide. Actually it is derived from bicarbonate, but remember that it is CO2, 2 for second carbon atom. And the glutamine, it's going to contribute to the third nitrogen of the pyrimidine ring. So aspartate alphabet A, so it is first one, so N1 is from aspartate. If you remember N1, the adjacent carbon atoms C4, C5, C6, they're all from aspartate. Then the other end, we have second carbon atom, it is CO2, it is carbon dioxide, the second carbon atom. The glutamine, the remaining nitrogen, it is contributed by glutamine, that is N3. So this is about the different atoms contributing to the pyrimidine ring. And by definition, the process of biosynthesis of pyrimidine nucleotides from various carbon and nitrogen precursors, which are contributed mainly by 2 amino acids, that are aspartic acid and glutamine. Remember, in the other way also, adenine and guanine starts with A and G. A for aspartic acid and G for glutamine. It is also contributing to the purine biosynthesis. If you remember the purines A and G, that is A for adenine, A for aspartic acid, G for guanine and G for glutamine. One basic amino acid, one acidic amino acid. So thus they are all going to contribute to the purine as well as to the pyrimidine ring. Now the pyrimidine ring, unlike in purine, we had first addition of phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate, which is going to contribute ribose 5 phosphate. But here it is just opposite to that of purine synthesis, because here the pyrimidine ring is synthesized in a free form. First it is the pyrimidine ring is synthesized, then the ribose 5 phosphate comes and adds. But in case of purine, first ribose 5 phosphate is required, on that the all the other molecules, amino acid derivatives comes and gets attached to them. So this is the important difference between the purine and pyrimidine biosynthesis. In the initial steps, we do not require ribose 5 phosphate. In the purine ring, it is mandatory in the first step itself. That is, we call it as a committed step or zero step, preparatory step. 9. The tissues, it operates in almost all the cells. All the tissues mainly operates in the liver, like we had in purine biosynthesis, mainly operating in the, similarly here also. And the 4 tissues which lack purine and pyrimidine de novo synthesis, like we have WBC, RBC, bone marrow, and so these tissues are going to lack these tissues are going to lack de novo synthesis, for which God has provided the salvage pathway. Similarly, in these tissues, the pyrimidines are being supplied by the salvage pathway. The site, it is operates in the cytosol, and the substrate that we require is carbamoyl phosphate and phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate. The enzymes, again, there are two enzyme complexes in the pyrimidine biosynthesis. One, we had a CAD sequence. The CAD represent the first alphabet of the first three enzymes of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. C stands for carbamyl phosphate synthetase 2, and A stands for aspartyl transcarbamylase, and D stands for dihydroorotase. These three are going to act as a multi-enzyme complex. They are located in the cytosol. The very fourth enzyme, that is dihydroorotate dehydrogenase, this is located in the mitochondria. It is going to it is going to represent a single enzyme. It is not in complex with any other enzymes. The other two complexes, that the other two enzymes which will form a single functional complex, are OPRTAs and OMP decarboxylase, that is orotate phosphoribosyl transferase and orotate monophosphate decarboxylase, that is OMP decarboxylase, and we have UMP kinase. So these two enzymes, the OPRT and OMP decarboxylase, these two are single functional enzyme complex. And again, these are located in cytosol. The first complex and the last single functional enzyme complex, they are located in the cytosol. The dihydroorotate dehydrogenase is located in the mitochondria. This is a fourth enzyme of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. There are totally six steps apart from the individual synthesis till the production of OTP. And the energy, it is supplied by the ATP, similar to that of purine. Purine biosynthesis requires consumption of six high energy phosphate bonds. And the other requirements that are required for the purine biosynthesis are amino acids, already we have discussed, and the cofactors like magnesium and the coenzymes like tetrahydrofolate, etc. So coming to the pathway improper, the step one. All of you please be careful about this step, because it's a very, very important link between the two pathways, which I'm going to explain in the coming slide. The bicarbonate, it's going to react with the glutamine. Once we say glutamine, what is the characteristic feature of glutamine? It is a basic amino acid. It has got amino group. So it is contributing to the third nitrogen of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. The bicarbonate reacts with the glutamine. That means the glutamine is going to donate its amino group. Thus, it forms carbamyl phosphate. You can see the amino group over here. It's a carbamyl phosphate. And during this step, it is requiring a consumption of ATP, because it's an energy requiring process. Once we say energy requiring process, most of the time the enzyme will be synthetase. The enzyme name is carbamyl phosphate synthetase. This is the first enzyme of your pyrimidine biosynthesis. Got my point? The bicarbonate reacts with glutamine. The amino group is transferred from the glutamine to the bicarbonate, resulting in the formation of carbamyl phosphate. It's an energy requiring process, and the enzyme is CPS2. And coming to the second step, the carbamyl phosphate, the CONH2 group is already added. Now it's going to combine with the aspartate. We already discussed the pyrimidine ring. The aspartate is going to contribute to the C4, C5, C6 and N1 of the pyrimidine ring. Now this aspartate amino acid is going to react with the carbamyl phosphate. Upon the reaction, the phosphate group gets eliminated, and this carbamyl group combines with the aspartate. You can look at the structure here. The aspartic acid having two carboxyl groups, and this is the structure of the aspartic acid with the carbamyl group, that is NH2CO group. With the elimination of phosphate, it becomes carbamyl aspartate. There are two carboxyl groups, and this amino group, which is derived from the glutamine in the first step, and this compound is called as carbamyl phosphate. At this junction, we should know what is the link between the urea cycle and pyrimidine biosynthesis. Can anyone guess what is the linkage between the urea cycle and pyrimidine biosynthesis? Until unless we understand this concept, the clinical significance, the further aspect of the cycle cannot be understood well. So now let us recollect from the amino acid metabolism, the very first cycle which we have, in the biochemistry, the first metabolic pathway that has been isolated was urea cycle, the year 1832. And this was the link between the pyrimidine and urea synthesis. Now look at the structure here. Look at the cycle. The carbon dioxide combines with ammonia. It forms carbamyl phosphate. What's the enzyme here? Carbamyl phosphate synthetase 1. Again, it requires ATP and magnesium as a cofactor. So the same carbamyl phosphate is also a first step precursor in the synthesis of pyrimidine biosynthesis, the same carbamyl phosphate. But the only difference is, now let us recollect what are the differences between CPS1 and CPS2. CPS1, it is located in the mitochondria. You can look at this as the mitochondria. and CPS2 it is located in the cytosol. CPS1 it is related to the urea biosynthesis. This is related to urea biosynthesis. CPS2 is related to pyrimidine biosynthesis. Now, the important difference, the third important difference between CPS1 and CPS2, the source of nitrogen for CPS1 is ammonia, free ammonia, whereas CPS2 it is glutamine. The source of nitrogen is glutamine. We already studied over there in the previous slide. And the fourth important difference is that there is a positive effector for this CPS1. In presence of N-acetylglutamine, that is called NAC, it is going to act as a positive effector to the CPS1. But we do not have such positive effector for CPS2. So can anyone tell me if there is any defect in this enzyme? Suppose if there is a defect in ornithine carbamyl transferase. So the carbamyl phosphate synthetase 1 is going to produce carbamyl phosphate. It has to combine with L-ornithine to form citrulline. Suppose if there is a deficiency of this enzyme, what can happen? Yeah, can any guesswork? This gets accumulated. This carbamyl phosphate may get accumulated. Then what will happen to carbamyl? What is the fate of carbon phosphate? Nothing. It just shifts into the cytosol. It flows into the cytosol and it is going to start your pyrimidine biosynthesis in excess. So leading to the excessive production of pyrimidines and orotic acid. So please remember this important linkage. So these are the important differences between CPS1 and CPS2. Now moving on to the third step. The carbamyl aspartate, with the removal of water molecule, the enzyme name is dihydroorotase. It is going to synthesize dihydroorotic acid. So you can look at the picture here. There is a formation of orotic acid here. And the carbamyl aspartate, it removes hydrogen molecule and thus there is formation of dihydroorotic acid. And upon dehydrogenation, dihydroorotic acid undergoes dehydrogenation. From the, it picks up the hydrogen molecules from NADPH and or NADH. It results in the formation of orotic acid. The enzyme name is, once we say coenzymes NAD or FAD, it is dehydrogenases, that is dihydroorotate dehydrogenase. The enzyme name is dihydroorotate dehydrogenase. What is the important difference between this enzyme, the other enzymes of pyrimidine biosynthesis? It is located in the mitochondria. Now it picks up the hydrogen atoms from the NADH and it puts it into the, there is a removal of this hydrogen molecules from the dihydroorotic acid. That is, upon dehydrogenation, there is an introduction of double bond. You can see upon the removal of hydrogen atoms, there is an introduction of double bond at the 5th and 6th position. Thus, there is a cyclization of the ring resulting in the formation of orotic acid. So, we got the precursor of our pyrimidine, that is your orotic acid. So, there is a removal of hydrogen atoms and the 5th and 6th, there is an introduction of double bond resulting in orotic acid formation. Now, I told you the ribose phosphate is added in the last step of the pyrimidine biosynthesis, but in case of purine, it is added in the initial step of the purine biosynthesis. Now look at the reaction. The orotic acid, it gets converted to orotidylic acid, that is orotidine monophosphate. Now the ribose 5 phosphate has to come and get attached to this orotic acid. How does it happen? What's the enzyme? That is OPRTase, that is orotate phosphoribosyl transferase. The PRPP is going to donate its ribose 5 phosphate group to the orotic acid molecule. Thus, ribose 5 phosphate goes and attaches here. Thus, it results in formation of orotidine monophosphate, as known as orotidylic acid, also called as OMP. So, these are the important steps of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. Now, coming to the last important enzyme of the synthesis till the formation of UMP is orotate decarboxylase reaction. The orotidylic acid undergoes decarboxylation. You can look at the diagram here in the previous slide. There was a COOH group attached at the second position. Now what has happened to this? At the fifth position, there was a COOH group. So what has happened to this? There's a decarboxylation, the removal of carbon dioxide from that orotidic acid. So upon decarboxylation, it gives rise to the formation of what is called UMP, that is uridine monophosphate. The ribose 5 phosphate was attached in the previous step. The CO2 group was removed from here. Thus, it becomes uridine monophosphate. If you recollect the structure of pyrimidines in the day before yesterday's class, we have discussed about the structure of and purines in total. So if you look at the structure of that, we have already discussed about the differences between the cytosine, uracil and thymine. I think you are quite aware of it. What is the important difference between uracil and thymine? Both are having 2,4-dioxypyrimidine, but at the fifth position there is a methyl group in case of thymine, but in case of uridine there is no methyl group. That's an important difference. Then how does cytosine differ from uracil and thymine? The cytosine has got an amino group. Apart from that, it does not contain dioxy, it contains only one oxy group and one amino group. I hope you remember that. Now look at the same, just remember the structure and just try to correlate here. The uridylic acid, that is UMP, is formed here upon decarboxylation of rotidylic acid. Now the UMP upon kinase reaction, whenever there is a kinase, it is a transferase reaction. It transfers its phosphate molecule to the substrate and it becomes uridine diphosphate with the help of an enzyme called kinase. Next, one more kinase comes into the picture and the ATP donates one more phosphate molecule, it becomes uridine triphosphate. Any doubts here? So UMP to UDP, UDP to UTP. So the first pyrimidine that is synthesized in the pyrimidine biosynthesis is U, that is UMP. Remember this. Just to try to remember in pyrimidines. In case of purines, it was first purine nucleotide that was formed was IMP. Here it is UMP. So the UDP gets converted to UTP. Then at the last step, the UTP is converted to CTP. That is uracil derivative is converted to cytosine derivative. How? The reaction goes like this. The UTP is converted to CTP with the help of an enzyme called CTP synthetase. Here the glutamine comes and gets added because cytosine differs from uracil how? With the presence of amino group. Uracil lacks amino group. Here the amino group has to be introduced into the uridine molecule. So the amino group donor is again glutamine. So with the help of cytidine CTP synthetase, it is going to consume a molecule of ATP, then it forms CTP, that is cytidine triphosphate. So thus we have UMP and we have CTP with us. Now coming to the summary of the pyrimidine biosynthesis, all of you please look at the diagram. Two molecules of ATP, carbon dioxide, glutamine, in presence of carbamyl phosphate synthetase 2, it's going to form carbamyl phosphate with the elimination of glutamate and ADP. With the transfer of aspartate group to the carbamyl phosphate, it becomes carbamyl aspartate. The job is done with the help of an enzyme called aspartate transcarbamylase. This carbamyl aspartate, with the removal of water molecule, with the help of dihydroorotate enzyme, it becomes dihydroorotate. These three enzymes, CAD, these are CAD sequences. These are represented as multi-enzyme complex. They are located in the cytosol. Dihydroorotate upon dehydrogenation with the help of, some books say FAD, some books say NADH, but it's you can remember it as either way. Dihydroorotate dehydrogenase, it forms orotate with the introduction of the double bond at the C5 and C6 carbon atoms. Now the orotate is ready now. This orotate gets its ribose 5 phosphate attached from PRPP with the help of an enzyme called orotate phosphoribosyl transferase and it forms OMP. Now OMP is converted to UMP upon decarboxylation. Thus CO2 group gets removed and it forms UMP. So that's about the summary of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. The fourth enzyme is dihydroorotate dehydrogenase, located in the mitochondria. The fifth enzyme, orotate phosphoribosyl transferase, and OMP decarboxylase is the sixth enzyme. This fifth and sixth enzyme, they are located as single functional enzyme complex. Now there is something called synthesis of ribonucleotides into the formation deoxyribonucleotides from ribonucleotides. The ribonucleoside diphosphate is converted to, this is very very important reaction, because in DNA we have deoxyribonucleotides. So we want deoxyribonucleotide. First the ribonucleotides are synthesized, then how they are converted into deoxyribonucleosides. Now the ribonucleoside diphosphates, they get converted to 2' deoxyribonucleoside diphosphate. The name of the enzyme is ribonucleotide reductase. The radio, it requires a protein called thioredoxin. What is this thioredoxin? Thioredoxin, first of all, it is a protein. Number two, it plays an important role in oxidation reduction reactions. Number three, it is a natural antioxidant present in the body. It is synthesized. Number four, it is synthesized in the body in an appropriate amount. Thus, this complex we collect as ribonucleoside diphosphate reductase complex. It has got a reduced thioredoxin. It is required for this particular reaction. Gets converted to oxidized thioredoxin. Simultaneously, what happens? The oxidized thioredoxin gets converted to reduced thioredoxin with the help of conversion of NADPH to NADPH. So this is the example to show the conversion of ribonucleotides into deoxyribonucleotides. Now, for example, if you talk about UDP, UDP is converted to deoxy UDP with the help of ribonucleoside reductase. Already I mentioned the enzyme here, that is ribonucleoside reductase, with the simultaneous conversion of thioredoxin, the reduced form, into oxidized form. Simultaneously, NADPH is converted into NADP+. So this is very, very important reaction to show the synthesis of deoxyribonucleosides. Now moving on to the next slide. Again, this is very, very important reaction, because this reaction is very, very important in case of folic acid metabolism, which is vitamin B complex metabolism, and one carbon metabolism. Number three, it is important in glycine metabolism. Number four, it is important in serine metabolism. So this reaction is almost common in all these four metabolisms. One vitamin, that is your folic acid, the amino acids like glycine, number four, number three, serine, then in pyrimidine biosynthesis as well. So this is a very, very important question, as well as it is an important reaction to show the one carbon metabolism. Look at the diagram here. The GUMP, that is 2,4-dioxypyrimidine, it gets converted to thymine. The important difference between uracil and thymine, presence of methyl group. Now we want methyl group for the thymine formation. How do we going to get this methyl group? It's a one carbon containing compound. It's going to be derived from the one carbon pool. Who is that going to contribute to the one carbon pool? N5N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate. It gives its methyl group to the DUMP, thus it forms DTMP. The enzyme name is thymidylate synthase. This methylene tetrahydrofolate becomes dihydrofolate. Simultaneously, dihydrofolate can be converted to tetrahydrofolate, which is a coenzyme form of your folic acid, vitamin B complex. The NADPH is converted to NADP+ with the help of DHF reductase enzyme. And the TFF, that is tetrahydrofolate, gets converted to N5N10 methylene tetrahydrofolate. Simultaneously, serine is converted to glycine. When you read about glycine metabolism, the synthesis of glycine from the serine, it's a very, very important reaction. Just remember this, that with the help of an enzyme called serine hydroxyl methyl transferase. It's an example for transmethylation reaction, which is a general reaction in case of amino acid metabolism. So that's about the synthesis of DTMP. Sometimes this alone can be asked about synthesis of deoxythymine monophosphate. So you should be ready with this answer. Now coming to the regulation of this particular enzyme, DUMP is converted to DTMP with the help of thymidylate synthase. We already discussed in the previous slide. There are two important drugs called 5-fluorouracil and methotrexate, which are used as anti-cancer drugs. They both are going to inhibit this particular step. The dihydrofolate reductase enzyme is inhibited by methotrexate. So this is how the anti-cancer drugs do act at the, you know, synthesis of DNA, how they are going to hamper it in the cancer cells, thus overcoming the symptoms. Coming to the regulation, I already said you there are two complexes, single functional enzyme complex, multi-enzyme complex, that is CAD sequence and the OPRTS along with OMP decarboxylase, which form as a single functional enzyme complex, and other enzyme dihydroorotate dehydroproteinated in the mitochondria. The regulation can be discussed under two different aspects, that is long-term regulation and short-term regulation. Once we say long-term regulation, it is at the gene level. Whenever sufficient pyrimidine biosynthesis is taking place in the body, the genes that are responsible for the production of the enzyme, CPS2, which is a regulatory enzyme of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. In eukaryotes, CPS2 is a regulatory enzyme, whereas in case of prokaryotes, ATC, that is aspartate transcarbamylase, is a regulatory enzyme. Remember this. CPS2 is a regulatory enzyme in eukaryotes. This is subjected to long-term regulation. When there is adequate amount of pyrimidines in the body, the CPS2 gets inhibited. The gene undergoes separation. Thus, CPS production gets hampered. There is a stoppage of CPS2. So, there is no more further production of pyrimidines. This is called long-term regulation. Coming to the short-term regulation, it is by the feedback inhibition. We have seen already in the purine metabolism, the purine nucleotides itself, they are going to inhibit the initial steps of the purine biosynthesis. Similarly, here also the end products like CTP, UTP, they are going to inhibit the initial steps, that is ATC enzyme and CPS2 of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. When you look at an important step here, that is cited in synthetase reaction. Cited in synthetase reaction and UDP formation. Which purine nucleotide is playing an important role for the synthesis of pyrimidines? ATP. Right? It is a purine nucleotide. Thus, for the pyrimidine biosynthesis to take place, purine nucleotides are required. Hence, the balance between the two has to be maintained very well in the cell. Whenever there is a adequate amount of this pyrimidines, like in the form of CTP, UTP, UMP, they are going to inhibit the initial step. So this is the linkage between the purine and pyrimidine biosynthesis. That's why always the balance has to be maintained, because the CTP itself requires ATP for its formation. Without ATP, there is no formation of CTP. Then moving on to the that's about the short-term regulation of the pyrimidine biosynthesis. Now coming to the salvage pathway, we have already discussed in purine, the same points holds good here also for the pyrimidine biosynthesis. It consumes less energy. The tissues which lack de-rover synthesis are going to depend on pyrimidine synthesis, like brain, WBC, RBC and bone marrow. And the pyrimidine base combines with PRPP. Again, PRPP is the initial precursor over here. Without the presence of PRPP, salvage pathway again doesn't operate. Hence, the balance between the PRPP production and its utilization has to be maintained in the cell. And this PRPP combines with each other in the presence of pyrimidine phosphoribosyl transferase, producing pyrimidine nucleotide with the release of inorganic pyrophosphate. Look at the pathway here. The cytosine combines with the PRPP to form CMP. Uracil combines with ribose 1 phosphate to form uridine and release of inorganic phosphate. Uridine combines with ATP to form UMP and ADP. Thymidine combines with ATP to form DTMP and ATP. Coming to the catabolism of pyrimidine nucleotides. What was the end product of catabolism of purines? We know it is uric acid. Similarly, for pyrimidines, let us look at the pathway. So, the pyrimidines are cytosine, uracil and thymine. Now, coming to the cytosine degradation. Cytosine deaminase, the name enzyme itself, you know, is saying that there's a deamination, removal of the amino group from the cytosine. Upon deamination, cytosine gets converted to uracil. Upon transamination, upon the addition of amino group, uracil gets converted to cytosine. Cytosine upon deamination gets uracil, and there is a addition of the oxygen because it's a dioxy. The uracil, with the help of an enzyme called dihydrouracil dehydrogenase, it forms dihydrouracil. There's addition of hydrogen groups. This dihydrouracil, with the help of an enzyme hydrase, it becomes beta-uridopropionate. This beta-uridopropionate is also called as carbamyl beta-alanine. Alanine is attached to the beta-carbon atom. With the removal of carbon dioxide and ammonia, help of beta-uridopropionase, it becomes beta-alanine. So this is the end product of cytosine metabolism or the cytosine degradation. Remember, do not get confused, cytosine gives rise to beta-alanine because the time and end product is different. So the cytosine gives rise to beta-alanine, CBA. C for cytosine, B for beta, A for alanine. Or you can remember it as CAB. CAB. Next is thymine. The initial step of degradation is similar to that of cytosine as well. The Thymin undergoes dehydrogenation to form dihydrothymine. NADPH is acting as a coenzyme here. The dihydrothymine gets converted to beta-uridoisobutyrate. It's also nothing but carbamyl beta-amino-isobutyrate. Upon removal of ammonia and carbon dioxide from this molecule, that is beta-uridoisobutyrase enzyme, it becomes BAIB, that is beta-amino-isobutyrate. The thymine gives rise to BAIB, B-A-I-B, BAIB, that is beta-amino-isobutyrate. So please do remember, it's a very, very important question, degradation of pyrimidines. Moving on to the clinical significance of the pyrimidine metabolism. We have something called orotic acid, the very first slide which I showed you the case history. Orotic acid urea, it is nothing but increased excretion of the orotic acid in the urine due to its increased production. So what are the causes? We have primary and secondary. Primary causes, most of the time they are focused on the enzyme defect. So depending upon the enzyme defect, there are two types of orotic acid urea, type 1 and type 2. Now, type 1 and type 2. In type 1, there are deficiency of both the enzymes, that is OPRTS as well as OMP decarboxylase, the fifth and sixth reaction of the pyrimidine metabolism. Orotic acid to OMP OPRTS, that is orotate phosphoribosyl transferase enzyme, and OMP gets converted to UMP with the help of OMP decarboxylase. If these two enzymes are defective, the orotic acid gets accumulated in the blood and gets excreted in the urine. So this is type 1. Type 2 orotic acid urea is due to deficiency of OMP decarboxylase. OPRTS remains to be normal and there's a deficiency of OMP decarboxylase, but still the patient will have orotic acid urea in type 2 as well. So these two are the important primary causes. So the patient will present with, I already said you, patient presents with the growth retardation because the accumulation of orotic acid in the body, in the blood, in the various tissues it affects, and finally it is leading to stunting of the growth and growth retardation. So you can look at the picture over here. The baby is presenting with severe growth retardation and the peripheral smear shows megaloblastica. Why? If these two enzymes are defective, the pyrimidine biosynthesis doesn't happen. If pyrimidine biosynthesis does not happen, what will happen? There is a decreased production of pyrimidine lipid proteins, which are essential for maintaining the RBC membrane integrity. If these proteins are deficient, what can happen? Though there is a disproportionate increase in the cell size leading to megaloblastic anemia or macrocytic anemia. So this is about the clinical presentation of, and the, because of the excessive accumulation of uric acid gets excreted in the urine resulting in crystal urea and stone formation, and patient will have recurrent urinary tract infection as well. So when you look at the secondary causes of orotic acid urea, the secondary causes are sometimes due to drugs like allopurinol and azoyuridine. This azoyuridine, it has got an inhibitory effect on OMP decarboxylase. The mechanism, it inhibits OMP decarboxylase, thus there is no pyrimidine biosynthesis. Orotic acid gets excreted in the urine. What is wrong with allopurinol? Allopurinol is going to compete with the orotic acid. For which enzyme? OPRTS enzyme. Allopurinol says, orotic acid, it's me who is going to bind to the OPRTS. I'm going to do my job. So the orotic acid gets, the enzyme gets inhibited and the orotic acid gets excreted. There is no more pyrimidine biosynthesis. Now, Reese syndrome. What is Reese syndrome? In Reese syndrome, there is a localized damage to the mitochondria. Once there is a damage to the mitochondria, what happens? I said you, CPS1, it is located in the mitochondria in urea cycle. All the carbamyl phosphate which was generated in the urea cycle as a result of urea cycle gets channeled into the cytosol. Now there is a increased production of orotic acid due to increased production of pyrimidines. Indirectly there is pyrimidine biosynthesis as well as, but the uric acid levels are more increased, is disproportionate. Then I already said you the linkage between the urea cycle, that is ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency. Because of this, the carbamyl phosphate is shunted into the cytosol, goes to the pyrimidine biosynthesis, excessive orotic acid production. So this is about the secondary causes of orotic acid urea. And coming to the treatment aspect, one has to be fitted with the cytidine and uridine because they are going to produce something called UTP, which has got an inhibitory effect of the on the enzyme called CPS2 and ATC as well. So the pyrimidine biosynthesis will be stopped. So let us move on on to the next topic, genetics. Please remind. So we are going to start genetics now. The very very interesting topic of the molecular biology. So we are going to start with the central dogma of the molecular biology, that is DNA. The DNA undergoes replication to form more and more copies of DNA. It undergoes transcription to form RNA and further translation to form protein. So the role of this RT is in the comes into the picture. Today's coronavirus diagnosis, the gold standard diagnostic tool for the coronavirus infection, is with the help of this enzyme, that is reverse transcriptase, which converts the viral RNA to viral DNA, and the DNA will be sequenced for the mutation. So the mutation analysis is done and thus the coronavirus infection is detected. So this is about the RT-PCR. This is a technique called reverse transcriptase PCR, which is running on the real time, and it's going to be the gold standard tool. So thus we are going to talk today about the replication first. This is central dogma of the molecular biology. We have different types of replication, like conservative, semi-conservative model and theta replication. Conservative means the as the DNA strands separate, the parental strands will not separate completely. When the newly synthesized forms are, when the newly synthesized DNA is formed, the parental one strand will contain, one duplex will contain only parental strand, the other duplex will contain only daughter strands. Whereas it is opposite in the semi-conservative. The newly synthesized duplex contains one parental strand and one daughter strand. And that is about the semi-conservative. Theta replication holds good for the bacterial, the prokaryotic replication, which is meant for the replication of circular DNA, as we see in case of E. coli, that applicable to the theta replication. The first observation was made by the Arthur Kornberg. He was the person who observed for the first time the role of DNA polymerase in the synthesis of DNA or the replication. Hence, it is known as Kornberg's enzyme. So the what is the primary goal of replication? The transformation of the genetic makeup of an individual from one individual to the another individual, from the parent to the daughter. That is the primary goal of this replication. DNA replication should be complete. Again, incomplete, it results in mutation and there is no genetic makeup as well. It happens, it operates with a high fidelity. The replication should be barely error-free. Otherwise, it can lead to so many disorders. The body has taken care in such a way that with the provision of certain enzymes like DNA polymerase, which has got exonuclease activity, it can repair itself. Whenever there is a wrong base is incorporated into the newly synthesized DNA, it is going to be removed with the help of exonuclease activity of the DNA polymerase itself. That's why the mutation rates are very, very less during the replication. So it happens with the high fidelity. Replication can occur only from the single. If you have a double stranded of DNA, we cannot synthesize one more copy of DNA. It's always single stranded DNA, which is acting as a template. There should be some mechanism to identify at what region of the DNA the replication has to start. That is called ORI, that is origin of replication. After completion, the parent and the daughter strand must form double stranded DNA. Then there is no point. If it forms single stranded DNA, there's no point about it. Again, in eukaryotes as well in prokaryotes, the semi-conservative method that we are going to study, the parental strands are not going to be degraded. The base pairing rule is the one which is going to allow that each strand will act as a template to the new strand. Thus, the new duplex will have half of the DNA from the parent and half of the DNA from the new. So when you look at the double-stranded DNA, this is separation, this is unwinding, and each single strand is acting as a template for the formation of the new daughter strand. This is called semi-conservative method of DNA replication. It's semi-discontinuous. There's something called lagging and leading strands, which you're going to study in the actual steps of replication. The leading strand is always is leading. It's continuous. There is no a failure of the strand. It's a leading student, like, so there is a continuation in its course, like that. Here the leading strand is continuous in its synthesis. lagging, someone is lagging behind in their study, definitely they will fail many times. Similarly, the lagging strand has got a breakages. They are called as Okazaki fragments. They need to be sealed. They need to be joined with the help of an enzyme called ligases. Now, we are going to discuss about this in the later slides. Look at the replication fork, which is showing the DNA. The double-stranded DNA, there's an unwinding at this position. The single-stranded DNAs are separated. This is 5' to 3', 3' to 5' direction. The one which is synthesizing in the direction of the replication fork, this is in the direction of the advancing replication fork, we call it as a leading strand because the synthesis is continuous. Remember, always the DNA replication synthesis happens in 5' to 3' direction. The strand which is serving as a template here is 5' to 3', which is the leading strand which is synthesizing. It is synthesized in the advancing of the replication fork. The strand which is synthesized in the opposite to the advancing replication fork, we call it as a lagging strand. Again, the synthesis has to be in 5' to 3' direction only. There's a discontinuous synthesis of DNA fragments over here. This is called as lagging strand. Remember, in the direction of replication fork, it is leading strand. In the opposite to the direction of the replication fork, it is lagging strand. Now coming to the definition, thus the definition goes like this: the process of synthesis of daughter DNA from parental DNA, it is not prenatal, it's a parental DNA, by the enzyme called DNA polymerase. It's a Korenberg enzyme. So first time it was identified in the E. coli. It's a DNA polymerase. To show it in a reaction way, the deoxy, that is nucleotide monophosphates, N number, reacts with deoxy triphosphates, resulting in the addition of more and more nucleotides with the release of inorganic pyrophosphate. So the DNA gets lengthened to lengthened DNA. Now coming to what are the basic requirements that we require for the replication to happen. We require a substrate, we require a template, we require enzymes and proteins. So these are the basic requirements for the replication to take place. Now let us look into the substrate aspects. What are the substrate we need? Deoxyribonucleotides. The DNA is made up of AGCT, adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. So they are required in the form of nucleotide forms. Let us see who are those. Deoxy, adenosine triphosphate, DGTP, CTP, deoxy, TTP. These are the four substrates that are required for the replication to proceed. Now coming to the template. I said you that the parental strand, the each parental strand after its separation, they are going to act as a template for the new daughter strand synthesis. So we need a template, that's parental DNA, the single stranded parental DNA, which is separated from the duplex DNA. Now let us have a look on the enzymes which are going to play a key role in the replication. First of all, we need a helicase. Please do remember, these are very, very important concepts. Number one, we need helicase. Number two, we need DNA polymerase. We need primase. We need ligase. Now, individual functions we are going to describe in the next slide. So, the DNA polymerase, it is related to the both prokaryotes as well as to the eukaryote DNA synthesis. In the prokaryotes, we have got three different types of polymerases, 1, 2, 3. Eukaryotes, we have got five different types of DNA polymerases, alpha, epsilon, beta, gamma and delta. Individually, we will discuss later. DNA helicase, what is the function of DNA helicase? It is to unwind the DNA. Double-stranded parental DNA is there with us. Now, they have to be separated into single-strand DNA. Who is going to do this job? With the help of an enzyme called helicase. Now, for every DNA synthesis, for the daughter molecule to synthesize, they need something called DNA primase enzyme. Why do we require DNA primase? This enzyme is required for the RNA primer synthesis. Without RNA primer, the DNA synthesis does not happen. Please note this point. Without RNA primer, the DNA, daughter DNA synthesis not going to operate. It's not going to happen. Then the nick sealing, we have a group of enzymes called nick sealing. Whenever the gap is created due to the cleavage, due to the breakage, therefore there should be someone to seal the neck. That is, the job is done by topoisomerase 1 and 2 as well as the DNA ligase. We are going to discuss in detail in the next slides. Now coming to the proteins which play an important role in the DNA replication are DNA A protein. Now helicase will go and bind to the parental DNA. Who is going to say him that you have to go and bind to that particular site only? That's job is done by DNA A protein. It will direct helicase, you please go and sit to the particular site, now you can start unbinding. This is a protein which is going to bind to that particular site where that replication has to happen. It's going to direct the helicase that it's your job is to unwind, it's your site of action is this, that is your DNA A protein. Now once the strands get separated, there should be someone to stabilize them, otherwise there is always tendency for both the strands to come and reunite again. The two parents, they are getting separated and there is always tendency that they reunite again. So who is going to stabilize? No, you have to remain in there in your own separation way, because the daughter has to synthesize here. Who is going to do that job? It is job is done by single strand binding protein. It is going to go on, the name itself is indicated, it is going to go and bind to the separated single strands. They are going to stabilize them so that there is no reunion of these two parental strands. There's something called TER binding protein. TER stands for termination. Once the replication sufficient length of DNA synthesized, now it's time to terminate. Who's going to say that? There is something called terminator sequences which are located on the DNA molecule. These terminator sequences are going to direct that now it's a time for replication to stop. This job is done by terminator binding. It goes and binds to the terminator sequences. Now it's going to stop the replication. Now coming to the individual functions of the enzymes, I told you what is the job of this DNA helicase. It comes and binds here at the parental DNA and it's going to start separating the parental DNA into the single strands. It acts like a zipper to unzip the DNA. Now DNA polymerases. Prokaryotes were three types and in eukaryotes we have alpha, beta, epsilon, gamma and delta. Now we are going to look at the individual function of them. Yeah, the DNA polymerase 1, the function of this is gap filling following DNA replication. It is helpful in the repair, recombination as well. Type 2 DNA polymerase present in prokaryotic cell. It is helpful in DNA proofreading as well as repair mechanism. DNA polymerase type 3, which is present in the E. coli, it is related to the leading strand synthesis. Remember this leading strand synthesis, that is polymerase 3. Now with respect to the polymerases in eukaryotes, beta DNA polymerase is related to the DNA repair mechanism, gamma is related to mitochondrial DNA synthesis, epsilon is related to the leading strand synthesis, alpha is related to, it is nothing but a primase, and the delta is related to lagging strand synthesis. Remember that the polymerase 3 in case of prokaryotes helps in the leading strand synthesis. In case of eukaryotes, the lagging strand synthesis job is done by delta. So this is the, these are some of the important overall that the polymerases are involved in DNA repair. They are involved in leading strand synthesis, lagging strand synthesis, and they are involved in the mitochondrial DNA synthesis. They are also involved in the synthesis of primase. So these are the functions of different DNA polymerases, both in prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes. The prokaryotic replication is better understood because the eukaryotic replication is more complicated, more participation of more and more proteins, more than 20 enzymes. So that makes it more complicated. So it is always better to compare and study about the replication. Now there's something called RNA primer. I told you without RNA primer that replication does not operate. Why? It is RNA primer, it is synthesized by the DNA primase. DNA primase is an enzyme which is helpful in the synthesis of RNA primase. DNA primase is also called as DNA dependent RNA polymerase. This enzyme helps in the synthesis of RNA primer. This RNA primer, it is nothing but a short piece of DNA, RNA. It is a short piece of RNA. It has got a nucleotide length of 5 to 50. There are about 5 to 50 nucleotides present in the RNA primer. Then, it's already said you, it is synthesized by the primase enzyme. It's also called as DNA dependent RNA polymerase. This synthesis is always in 5' 3' direction. Now, it acts as a starter sequence for DNA polymerase 2. DNA polymerase 2, it is acting as a starter sequence. And one RNA for the leading strand synthesis, we do not require multiple RNAs. It is only single continuous strand synthesis. So we require only one RNA primer. What is the role in case of lagging strand? There are multiple Okazaki fragments. The more and more Okazaki fragment, the more RNA primers we do require. The RNA primer requirement depends upon the Okazaki fragments in case of lagging strand. Now the RNA primer has got a free hydroxyl group to which the first nucleotide is attached. Now moving on to the energy for replication. The nucleotides itself, they provide the energy for the replication. The triple phosphate bonds, which are going to release the high energy bonds, and the DNA base arrive with their own energy for bonding. The bond, the linkages between the two base pairs is done by the with the help of an enzyme called DNA polymerase. I told you they are playing an important role in leading strand synthesis, lagging strand synthesis, and DNA repair mechanism, mitochondrial DNA synthesis. Coming to the steps. So these are the requirements. What all we studied about the initial requirement, we said we need a substrate in the form of DATP, DGTP, DCTP, DTTP. Enzymes, we said about helicase, we said about ligase, we said about topoisomerases, we said about the DNA polymerases. These are the various enzymes. Then about the proteins, we said about the DNA A protein, we said about single strand binding protein, then we said about the terminator binding protein. So these are all the basic requirements. Now let us see where all this come into the picture. There are three important steps of replication: initiation, elongation and termination. Now, initiation step. Once we say initiation, the first step. At the first, we need to identify what is the site of synthesis. Identification of ORI. ORI means origin of replication. Where does this ORI site is located? This ORI site is located in the place where there is a rich adenine and thymine base pairs. The region which is rich in adenine and thymine, that region will act as a ORI. Now who is going to say, this is the ORI? Your DNA A protein. It's going to say that this is a site for origin of replication because it comes and binds. You can see these proteins, ORI proteins, which are coming and binding to the site and saying that this is the site of replication. AT region, denaturation, unwinding will occur. Binding up, this I will explain you in the next slide. So the first step is identification of ORI. The ORI is located in the region where it is rich in adenine and thymine. For the identification, the ORI proteins play an important role. They are nothing but DNA A proteins. I guess you got my point. Now look at the difference between the prokaryotes and eukaryotes. In prokaryotes, it's a circular DNA. There is a single site of ORI. Look at the eukaryote, there are multiple sites. And it's a double strand linear DNA. There are multiple sites of ORI. They are called as consensus sequences. These consensus sequences, they are rich in AT rich region, which was the mandatory for ORI. So the multiple sites of origin ORI is called as consensus sequences in case of eukaryotes. In case of prokaryotes, they are simply called as ORI. The overall, it is called as autonomous replicating sequences. Autonomous replicating sequences, whereas they are called as ORI in case of prokaryotes. Now, when you look at the ORI, once the helicase comes and binds to the ORI, there is a unwinding. You can see the unwinding started here, local opening of the double helix in both the pictures. But since it is a single strand, since it is a circular DNA, you can look at the, once the unwinding happens, it is looking something like an eye. Human eye, it looks like an eye. That is called replication bubble. We call it as replication bubble. Once the unwinding happens, the strands get separated with the formation of replication fork. Similarly, in case of eukaryotes, we have a consensus sequences, and once the helicase comes and binds over here, there's an unwinding of the double-stranded DNA. You can see lagging leading strand directions, so resulting in two daughter DNA molecules, each one containing half of the parental DNA and half of the daughter DNA. Here you can see the two circular DNA that are generated as a result of replication. One round of synthesis involves about 4 million nucleotide in each strand of DNA, which completes in 40 minutes. It's going to complete the 4 million base pair addition within 40 minutes. Just look at the beauty of this replication. Helicase comes and binds and it starts unwinding. I already said you, this is the fourth step of initiation. Next, the fifth step of initiation is that once the strands get separated, the single strand binding proteins come and bind to the separated parental DNA, and they are going to stabilize them so that there will not be reunion or the binding of the DNA molecule. So they will basically maintain the unbinding nature of the helicase. Now there is something called supercoils. Whenever the DNA is started unwinding, see, it started unwinding over here. It is going in this direction. The double-stranded DNA, it started unwinding because of the presence of helicase enzyme. The single-stranded DNA are separated. What will happen to the structure beyond this? There is something called supercoils. How do we demonstrate supercoils? When you can take an example of a telephone card. Telephone supercoil, it's like coils, that card. In the olden days, we used to use the telephone. So one hand, if you grasp it, with the other hand, if you twist it, one hand you grasp it tightly, the telephone card, with the other hand, you twist it. If the tightening in the same direction of the supercoils, we call it as positive supercoils. The DNA gets, twisted around its axis. When we twist the card in the tightening direction of the coils, the DNA gets twisted, resulting in formation of supercoils. Similarly, the same telephonic card, which got a coils, which is, if you are going to twist it in the loosening way of the coils, then the DNA wraps in the opposite direction and resulting in what is called as negative supercoils. So whenever there is an unwinding process in a DNA, there are formation of positive and negative supercoils. Now, is this going to be good for the replication to proceed without removing this positive supercoils? No. So the positive supercoils has to be taken care. So who is going to do this job? This job is done by group of enzymes called topoisomerases. This topoisomerases are going to be of two types, topoisomerase 1 and topoisomerase 2. Topoisomerase 1 is present both in prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes. Whereas topoisomerase 2, it is also present in both prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes. What is the job of topoisomerase 1? Topoisomerase 1 is going to attack or is going to act only on the single strand DNA. It has nothing to do with double strand. It is going to introduce a cut or the break here. Thus, the supercoils are going to be relaxed. Once you cut it at this point, so there will be relaxation of the supercoils. Now, who is going to do this gap sealing? The same enzyme is going to do the same job. Topoisomerase 1 has got both nuclease activity as well as ligase activity. With the help of nuclease activity, it is going to break the single strand over here, and the nick sealing is done by the ligase activity of the same enzyme. So this is the story of topoisomerase 1. Now let us look at topoisomerase 2. How does it do? Topoisomerase 2, the diagram, if it is visible over here, the topoisomerase 2 cannot act on single strand DNA. It acts only on the double strand DNA. You can look at here. It is causing the break in the double stranded DNA. Thus the supercoils gets relaxed. And again the neck sealing is done by the same activity, that is ligase activity of this enzyme. So this is something about the topoisomerase 2 and topoisomerase 1. The best example for topoisomerase 2 is the bacterial enzyme called DNA gyrase. It's an example for topoisomerase 2. There is a very famous anti-cancer drug called etoposide. It's going to inhibit the topoisomerase 2. Now coming to the primase. I told you the DNA primase is required for the RNA primer synthesis. This is the primase enzyme. It is going to come and bind to the unwinded portion of the DNA, and it's going to synthesize what is called as RNA primer. Since this is a lagging strand, you can see many RNA primers, 1, 2, etc. Here there is only one RNA primase. It is a leading strand. So this is the complex is called as primosome complex. The binding of single-stranded binding protein along with polymerase alpha with primase and RNA primer, the complex we call it as primosome complex. Now the synthesis of DNA takes place at the RNA primer. Now coming to the formation of the replication fork. Once the unwinding proceeds, there is a formation of replication fork. This is in 3', 5' and 5', 3' direction. One is the leading strand, which is progressing in the advancement of the replication fork. The synthesis is always in 5' to 3' direction, is called as leading strand. One which is away from the advancing replication fork, we call it as lagging strand, which is in 5', 3' direction. The discontinuous synthesis of DNA in 5', 3' direction, in the direction which is away from the advancing replication fork, is called as lagging strand. The continuous synthesis of DNA in 5', 3' direction, in the direction of advancing replication fork, is called as leading strand. The lagging strand produces something called Okazaki fragments. Now, what are this Okazaki fragment? All of them have got their own DNA polymerase, their own DNA primase for the synthesis of RNA primer. Now look at the picture over here. This is the 5', 3', and 5', 3'. This is the parental DNA molecule. The DNA gyrase is nothing but topoisomerase 2, and this is a leading strand, and this is the lagging strand. There's a discontinuous synthesis and there's a continuous synthesis. These are Okazaki fragments. Now we are going to discuss about the Okazaki fragment in the elongation step. Now the RNA primer is there. The DNA primase has already synthesized RNA primer. Now there is an addition of the deoxyribonucleotide that are required for the replication. Now let us look at how it happens. The addition and the phosphodiester linkage is done by DNA polymerase. See, this is a RNA primer. This is RNA primer. The deoxyribonucleotides have to be added to the RNA primer for the synthesis to continue. Who is going to do this job? DNA polymerase. It's going to pick up DCTP, one of the nucleotide, deoxyribonucleotide, and it's going to add it to the RNA primer. It's going to add to the RNA primer with the removal of phosphate molecules. So thus you can see the phosphodiester linkage over here. At the free third hydroxyl group of the ribose, that is third hydroxyl group of the ribose, it is getting attached at the 3' end, that is 3 hydroxyl group of the ribose to the 5' end of the sugars. So this is about the formation of phosphodiester linkage between the deoxyribose and the existing RNA primer ribose sugar. Now, so that is how the DNA polymerase does its job. Now the elongation continues with the addition of more and more deoxyribonucleotides. Now what are these Okazaki fragments? The new short newly synthesized DNA fragments formed on lagging template strand during replication, we call it as Okazaki fragments. In prokaryote, the Okazaki fragments have got a length of 1000 to 2000 nucleotides. In case of eukaryotes, it is 150 to 200. And each Okazaki fragments are separated by the RNA primer, which is about 10 nucleotide in length. Then one Okazaki fragment joins with another Okazaki fragment with the help of an enzyme called ligase. Upon completion of the lagging strand synthesis, the RNA primers are removed by DNA polymerase 1. It also fills the gap that is formed due to the removal of the primer. DNA polymerase alone, it cannot join the two polynucleotide chains. This job is done by ligase. I'll explain you in the diagram, you will understand. So look at the diagram here. So this is a replication fork, this is a leading strand, this is lagging strand. There are RNA, we are talking about lagging strands now. There are RNA primers depending upon number of Okazaki fragments. After addition of deoxyribonucleotides, each fragments have to join together. First they have to remove the RNA primer. RNA primer is elongated by DNA polymerase until another stretch of RNA is encountered. It's going to get elongated until the another stretch of RNA is encountered. Till it comes closer to the another RNA primer, it is going to be increasing. The RNA primer is excised. You can see here the RNA primer. This portion is excised here. This is one RNA primer. This is one RNA primer having deoxyribonucleotides attached to it. The RNA primer portion is getting excised. It's going to get removed with the help of an enzyme called DNA polymerase 1. Now, once this primer is removed, this gap has to be filled. Who is going to do this job? This remaining nick is sealed by the DNA ligase enzyme. Thus, we can see the single continuous strand. That means the joining of the lagging strand, that is Okazaki fragments, happens with the help of two things. One is with the removal of RNA primer, another with the gap sealing with the help of an enzyme called ligase. The formation of phosphodiester bond by the ligase enzyme. So this is how the phosphodiester linkage is formed between the base pair. You can see this is a leading strand, there is a continuous synthesis, there is no problem in the leading strand, but in the lagging strand definitely the deoxyribonucleotides of the each RNA primer removed regions, they have to be joined with the help of phosphodiester linkage. Now that's about the elongation part, and coming to the termination part. In the termination, what happened? The specific sequences called termination sequences are going to direct at a time to terminate the DNA replication. Who is going to do this job? The terminator binding protein comes and binds to these terminator sequences, and this thus prevents the helicase for further unwinding and thus facilitating the termination. It won't allow the helicase further to function for unwinding. It stops at that region and it's going to terminate the replication. Coming to the, once the replication is done, the mutation rate is very, very less. How is this happening? The DNA is copied with a high fidelity. The incorrect nucleotide frequency is 1 in, you can look at the figures, 108 to 1012 bases. 1 in 108 to 1012 base pairs, which is going to lead to mutation. But the error rate is very, very less because of the proofreading activity. All the three DNA polymerases have got a proofreading activity in terms of exonuclease activity, which is in the 3'5' direction. DNA polymerase 1 and 2 excise mismatched nucleotide before the introduction of the next nucleotide. I will show you in the diagram. We can look at here how the enzyme actually functions. This is 3'5' exonuclease activity. Look at here, the cytosine, the base pairing rule. Cytosine has to pair with the guanine. Unfortunately, there is a mismatch. There is adenine. Now, definitely, this is going to result in a mutation. Then, how does the cell protect it? Now, this mismatched base pair is removed by the 3'5' exonuclease activity. This DNA polymerase comes into the picture. It takes away its adenine because the guanine is the one which has to be paired with the cytosine. With its exonuclease activity, it's going to remove the adenine, and now the site is empty. The next base, that is the guanine, comes and pairs with the cytosine. So this is about the proofreading activity of the polymerase. So that's how these are all the important aspects about the replication. And do study this, may come for the main question as well. So some of the important differences between prokaryote and eukaryotic replication I would like to tell as a last part of the slide. In prokaryotic replication, we have DNA polymerases, three varieties. In case of eukaryotes, we have five varieties: alpha, beta, epsilon, gamma and delta. And in case of prokaryote, the Okazaki fragment length is somewhere between 1000 to 2000 nucleotide base pair, whereas in case of eukaryote, the Okazaki fragment length is 150 to 200. Is it clear? The best example for prokaryotic topoisomerase 2 is gyrase, but we do not have the gyrase enzyme in our body. We have topoisomerase 2. And these are the some of the very, very important differences between and individual DNA polymerase differences. You have to learn by heart about DNA polymerase 1, 2 and 3 and alpha, beta, gamma and delta, what the different functions of these enzymes. And so the three important steps of replication are initiation, elongation and prolongation. So the various pictures have been showed, and please make a note on this replication. So the question will be like define replication, various steps involved in the replication, write a short note or add a note on proofreading mechanism of DNA polymerase. So you should be able to answer this question. So we'll meet you in the next class with the DNA repair mechanisms. Thank you.